Hello there! Welcome to Animated Anarchy. I'm the artist. Everyone has their favorites when it comes to cartoon characters, whether you relate to them or just find them entertaining. For me, of course, one of my all-time favorite characters in animation history has to be Felix the Cat.
Created by animator Otto Mesmer under Pat Sullivan Studios, Felix debuted in his first animated silent short film, Feline Follies, in 1919, under the name of Master Tom. This was well before the time of Mickey Mouse and even Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. At the time, Felix was known to be one of the most critically acclaimed characters of film, and to this day, his classic cartoons are considered to be fine pieces of historic and surrealist art. It wasn't until the advent of Walt Disney and the first cartoon to feature sound, Steamboat Willie, that the inkblot cat's popularity was pushed back a bit. Though he was given a handful of new cartoons that were in color and sound, Felix wasn't given a true revival until his television series in 1958, when Mesmer passed the torch to Joe Oriolo in King Features Syndicate. As odd as it was, the series would soon become the staple of Felix the Cat in animation for years.
Felix was also given another revival on Saturday mornings in 1995, called The Twisted Tales of Felix the Cat, a series I actually quite enjoyed. And yes, I am aware of the Baby Felix anime, but I'm not going to touch on that insanity quite yet. Nope, I'm going to talk about that void in between. Brace yourselves, folks. This is the Felix the Cat movie.
In the late 80s, Oriolo's son, Don Oriolo, made plans to create a television revival for his father's version of the cartoon cat, which would have begun as a feature-length pilot. The animation was produced by a Hungarian studio and wasn't given an official release until 1991. It did, however, premiere a few years earlier in a single theater in Los Angeles, but for the most part, its views were limited to both television and VHS.
So how did the Felix movie fare? Well, we're gonna find out. So let me just put on my anti-freak-out glasses, and we'll begin! Oh, these are just a precaution. Last time I saw this movie, I ended up in an alleyway with nothing but my underwear on. and a dead body next to me.
Our tale begins with the disembodied, computer-generated head of Felix the Cat.
Oh, hi everybody! Glad you could make it!
It's, not too late to get your own pair of these, folks.
I just got back from the land of Oriana. Never been there? That doesn't surprise me. They don't have an airport.
I don't know about you, but as I watch this, I can't help but feel like I'm watching the intro to a theme park ride.
Please place any items inside the compartment in front of you, and keep your hands and arms inside the vehicle at all times. Don't want to lose those limbs. Seriously, though, you might die.
You see, Oriana is in another dimension. That might sound far away, but it's closer than you think. One thing's for sure, though. Trouble is trouble.
Before we can grasp what the hell Felix is talking about, we cut to Middle Earth, where we're introduced to... Oruwa? Huh?
Come in, Grumper. You know you don't have to knock.
Wow. Just wow. Look at that.
Now, I'm not one to judge, but that just looks like it was designed by someone who read one of those step-by-step How to Draw Princesses books.
Well, certainly the next character might prove to be a bit more... Wow. Okay, I'm only 2 minutes in and have already lost all confidence in this. Admiral Mushface starts talking about some things no one cares about until some crazy woman bursts in through the door and shows off a card that says...
Now tell us what you've seen on the card.
Black duck on a green planet. You see, you cannot deny.
deny that.
Wait a second, which tarot card is that?
It's him, your uncle. It's the Duke of Zill.
Oh, obviously. But that's not much of a prediction, as you see, it's happening right outside as you speak.
May I remind you, Princess Oriana, that since you disbanded the army, there is now no defense against such a possibility.
Thank you, Grumper. I don't need to be reminded.
Actually, you kind of do need to be reminded, because that's a pretty important flaw in your defenses.
I suggest you use the secret railway, then the Demens Porter.
Oh! The Demens Porter, of course!
The princess and crazy lady run off into some caverns as they're pursued by... Wow, again. Jeez, these robots look like they're in a traveling rave.
They hear everything.
Oh, dear, stop!
Well, then shut up.
Lights on!
Hang on, is that a garbage truck? Did that computer just yawn? Wait, what's going on? What the hell is that? A teardrop? It's turning gold? It talks?
Stop! Just stop! I need to collect myself for a minute here. Never have I been so thrown off about the first plot point of a movie before.
But most of all, I'm sure you're wondering the same thing I am at this point. Where in Squiddly Diddly is Felix? This is his movie, right? I mean, I didn't misread the title, it actually said Bland Pig-Nosed Princess the Movie. Can we get on with this?
Input voice starter, input.
So, whatever, this golden tear that the princess excreted actually managed to open this dimension thing, and we finally reach our main hero. Now wait a second, doesn't this kind of remind you of a little something? You know, princess gets kidnapped by evil faceless monster, only to be rescued by a hapless stranger?
Hello? Hey! Listen! Watch out!
Wah! My magic bag!
Anyhow, Felix starts to chase the sparkling teardrop. And while he's doing that, one of Felix's little quirks is that he tends to make a lot of jokes. Yeah.
Let the cat out of the bag! Felix's road service. Fill her up. I think I'm starting to fall for you.
I'm laughing on the inside. Either that or I'm having an ulcer.
You'll notice right away that a lot of things from the 60s cartoon are beginning to show up, like Felix's not-so-subtle Mickey Mouse-like voice, the magic bag, etc., etc. But hey, what else was in those cartoons? Oh yeah, this guy, who, actually, I think all this time has only been known as the Professor. And might I also point out, these were some of his finest moments.
I must think. I made a boo-boo. What a fool I'd be! Bah!
Lest we forget, he also has a nephew named Poindexter, who I'm guessing is the actual brains of the family.
What? What's happening?
He is juggling with something.
What is he up to?
The professor does nothing. Every time we see these guys, the nephew is the one doing anything, whether it's actual invention or just pointing something out. All that professor wants is...
The bag! Stupendous! Yes, yes, the bag! I've always wanted that bag!
Yes, yes, Uncle, we hear you. The magic bag, that's right.
Anyway, back to Felix, we... Or Fox's song? Come on, really? Did we really need this song right now? I realize at the time there was some unwritten rule that animated features must have songs in it, but you can't just suddenly decide to put a song anywhere. Or is this your excuse to have a fox struggling to take a piss on Felix's magic bag?
Because honestly, I think that cat's been pissed on enough already. Get that away from me.
Huh, back on track. Felix manages to follow the little teardroplet down a rabbit hole. It's here we realize that his yellow bag really is actually magic, as it transforms into whatever he desires.
Let's see if you can still
Hey, I had powers like that once. But then I lost them when Satan realized I had already lent my soul to someone else.
Boy, could you use a Big Mac, huh?
Would you like some fries with that joke? Do you see why I prefer the silent films?
Ooh, did you see that? That skull just destroyed the powers of Felix's magic bag! Just like... no... but, yeah, the more I think about it, the more this is starting to seem like a video game. In fact, there was a video game on the NES!
Felix transformed into a bunch of stuff with his magic bag, and when he got hit, he'd lose that power.
I'm not saying that there's a connection to all this, but what am I talking about? I'm looking way too deeply into all this crap. Where are my glasses? Whew. Suddenly everything seems so much more sane.
So the mind stage is over. The Felix enters that dimension porter thingy, and they teleport back to Oriana. There's that garbage truck again.
Whoa!
We've taken you as far as we can. Now it's up to you.
Hey, wait!
Well, I guess the most reasonable response to that is to take a jackhammer to the wall, but he ends up creating another hole entirely that floods the entire place. It's here we're introduced to our first descent into insanity.
Welcome to Underwater Stupidity. Here we see the rare creatures simply known as the Living Frog's Legs. A creature so pathetic that it does not even comprehend its own existence. We move in deeper into the blue as fantastically idiotic sea life is abound, openly willing to take their own lives for the sake of the planet, so that better, more incredible creatures may take over the sea. And here we see the elusive sea skank performing a seemingly disgusting display in search for a mate, until it realizes that he will not find one, and slowly, as if nature has intended, become extinct.
When the dangerous punk ray shark appears, Felix makes a quick getaway, only to be led into a swamp, where we're greeted by the local color. Oh dear God, I hope that's mud on his hat.
Howdy, stranger. Welcome to the land of Zill.
Whoa, Felix, watch out, he might be a bad guy.
So anyway, this yokel is called Pim. Yeah, brilliant naming. Becoming our guide for most of the swamp, who, for whatever reason, decides to give us yet another riveting nature tour.
Them's turbos. I guess they're a kind of plant animal. This here's the turbo plant. But when turbos are ripe, you better be careful.
Look, who cares? If you can't kill it, season it, and grill it, is it really worth mentioning?
Yuck! Where are we? New Jersey?
Well, I don't know. That place is kind of trashy, but unless something like this happened... it's probably safe to say you're somewhere else other than New Jersey.
Actually, according to Pim there, the nearest city is called Progress City, which I suppose is just where they're headed. Until a sudden change of plans when Felix is captured by one of those cherry chocolate fudge ice cream things. He's pulled up by Cletus and told by some nearby raver robot to bring him back to...
bring him to Whack.
Whack? What the hell is up with these names? Oh, well, forget that. Let's go back to those mines, shall we? Where we see the Professor and Poindexter hot on the trail.
The mirror is Oriana backwards.
Well, as dumb as that is, it's also a bit of a relief as they could have slipped into the town of Nilbog.
Oh my God!
After some exposition, probably only to explain solely to this guy, Poindexter unleashes his latest invention. You know, just because you can animate it doesn't necessarily mean you have to.
To Oriana and Felix!
Poindexter, you know how to drive this thing? Look out!
It's a lot smoother ride on the freeway.
After that unnecessary scene, we find Felix has been captured by a local circus owned by... there's that freaking garbage truck again! Ugh, anyway, this is whack. Some sort of crocodile creature with a big neck scar from, I don't know, a throat condition? This character is basically our first villain, who constantly emphasizes all his Z's.
Smidge is zips. Z is...
And has a pen with an ugly face on it that does a terrible Donald Duck impression.
What would it do?
Pym tries to sell off the magic bag, but apparently it doesn't work without Felix. So Wack gets the idea to set him up as the latest attraction.
You don't know what you're doing, but this is an insult!
You know what? There is just way too much damn ugly in this scene, so I'm just gonna skip to the next and... What the hell? These idiots again? You know, last time I checked, this was called Felix the Cat the Movie. Instead, we're treated to so much more, and what is that more? Nothing! Why are we treated to these images? Are they supposed to set the mood about Oriana? So far, the only message I've gotten off of this world is that it's an insane, demented crap hole. Oh, now you're bringing in Felix? Huzzah! What does this magical scene have to offer?
Let's try again. What is your name?
Pym, what are you doing?
Come on, man. Is this some sort of new age exercise routine? Are you trying to do a rain dance?
Listen.
Or, hey, is this just some sort of power that the rave bots have? Because I gotta be honest, those things don't necessarily give me the I-gotta-dance vibe. Well, anyhow, the Carnival of the Damned begins, and we're greeted to Progress City's national anthem, which is...
At the magnified world of my bowels, aren't I?
I would call this creative. I mean, these creatures are pretty unique and weird and everything, but really? I can't stand looking at them. All of these things come off as some sort of alien rejects from a Robert Crumb comic. This place is called Progress City. What exactly makes these things progressive? They're more of a step back, actually. They even cut to what I feel is the perfect visual of what this song represents. Misery.
And now for something completely different.
Tap dancing misers!
Thank you. And now, right here at our stage, Felix the Cat and his traveling cat band.
I've never really done anything like this before. I said I've never really done this before. And I've never been in prison before either.
You know, that's not something I would have opened up with, but I guess your material kill.
I mean, prison's not so bad. It keeps you off the street.
This is bad comedy.
I mean, who is this Duke of Zill anyway? He's the one who's got me into this pickle. Zill Pickle, get it?
This isn't funny!
Well, apparently Felix's stand-up routine isn't doing much for the audience, and I'm running out of not-funny videos, so he moves on to prop comedy.
I hope I don't tire a bit!
Felix, maybe you might want to use your magic bag to, I don't know, save yourself? Anyway. Apparently Oriana is also part of this circus, so what exactly does she have to offer for this?
No, not enough stripping. Next!
While this is all happening, we... Thank you, text. The Duke of Zill, accompanied by that mushy-faced guy in the beginning. Ooh, I'd find that shocking except for the fact that I was hoping I wouldn't see him again.
I don't see why we have to watch it night after night.
You're wrong, you Scugnant Prolifister!
Scugnant Prolifister? Come on, if you can't come up with more creative curse words than Captain Haddock, then don't even try.
Numbcrut.
Shh,
Princess, listen. I have a plan to get us out of here.
What? That's rather a cruel joke, don't you think?
Hey, lady, that's Felix the effing cat. He's the only character that actually looks like he could be a good guy, and you just blow him off? Seriously, at this point, I think it's safe to rethink rescuing her. But no, Felix ends up back in his cage and meets up with those,
lizards? Mice? Oh, mizzards!
No, this is the wrong wordplay. Let's try again, shall we? Eh?
I want you to tell me how you get in here.
That simple holes.
Felix uses these mice to create a hole to get to Oriana's cell, waking her up.
You are cruel. Did they send you here to torment me again?
Man, Oriana's a bitch. I mean, all this time, she's all about being kind to everyone and whatever. And then she meets up with the only person who actually manages to offer some help, and she's like...
But you're the only one who came?
Yep.
You're the dark stranger?
Yep.
Okay, you're on your own, princess. Screw this, I'm going home.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. Tell me how you got here.
It's a long, sad story. Are you sure you want to hear it?
No.
Of course I do.
Ugh, damn you.
Backstory time. Settle back, people. Maybe we'll finally get an explanation for all of this.
The land was peaceful, happy. But there was one person who didn't like the way things were, my uncle.
They will love me for this.
But will it work when it gets bigger?
Of course! Of course!
He was horribly disfigured, but using scientific know-how, he rebuilt his body. And so the Duke was banished to the land of Zil.
Your uncle was horribly disfigured, so your father banished him from the kingdom? You are horrible, horrible people! No wonder this guy doesn't like you!
But look at yourself! You're more disfigured than him! I think you deserve to be where you are! Felix, don't fall for her trap! She's a freaking monster!
The reptilian creatures there took him to be a god.
Nope, don't care.
They thought he was there to help them.
Nuh-uh, not listening.
But all he cared about was returning to Oriana.
You know what? Even if he killed all of these things right now, I still wouldn't care.
Come here, Felix. I'm hungry for your soul.
Well, unfortunately, the show must go on. However, this time, Felix devises a plan for escape. I should hope. As he accompanies Oriana in her dancing act, or whatever, see if you can follow this. Using his magic bag, he creates a bunch of bubbles and transforms Oriana's bubble into his bag, whatever. So they all end up floating outside of the top of the circus tent. This, of course, upsets the Duke.
Scrat, we're escaping! Pick me up! My back is out again!
Am I supposed to take this villain seriously? It's pretty hard not to laugh at something that looks like Mysterio hanging on wires at the Spider-Man musical.
Black Lizardy!
Accompanied by Pym, who is now a good guy, I suppose, they hitch a ride on some metal horse thingies.
What, was Pym's rave bod not available?
Honestly, at this point, I have no idea where they're going or what they're hoping to accomplish, but...
My bag! I just realized I left it behind!
You kidding me? You were just seen holding it! But that's not really important either, as those rave bots are not far behind. So they ride off and... what the hell? I didn't edit that. This actually happened, folks. The professor just casually rides along with Felix's bag. How coincidental. He could have just ran off with it. He's the one that's been waiting for it all this time.
I made a boo-boo. I made a boo-boo. I made a boo-boo.
Too bad the lizards aren't here with us.
Wait, why the hell did she bring that up?
Oh, no!
Look out! Suddenly rave bot! Look out again!
Stella! Stella! I could have been somebody.
Did I just... Work, damn you, work!
Stella! Stella! I could have been somebody.
The sudden tension is thwarted because they're at the swamp now?
Better make as much time as we can before dark. Can't travel then.
There's no indication of danger at this point. But...
Okay, ready to go.
Wait, what? Did that just happen off screen or something? You couldn't afford an explosion? What in sweet snagglepuss is going on here? Now in Face Mountain.
Is it safe to cut through this hair forest?
Hair forest?
Now this here hair forest is home to the headhunters.
Headhunters? What? Blood? Where'd that come?
But we'd better head out of here.
Oh!
Hang on, her dress wasn't finished.
It's the headhunter.
Headhunter? Wait. No. Huh? Where? What? No! Come on!
Oh yeah, I gave up. No, seriously, I gave up on this movie. I mean, how many times can one movie just go off on a tangent before it ends up collapsing over itself? There were some really, really weird things in this movie, but that was just taking it way too far. But you know, it's almost, hopefully, over. So I will be the better man and continue. Proceed.
Get it down with fire. Make more with fire. Bang, bang.
So Felix and the gang end up sneaking into Oriana's castle, which is now covered in salt crystals? Oh, who cares?
Came to be gay, let's rejoice with the boys in the gay ring. Hooray for the kind of man that you would find in the gay ring.
Hooray for the man!
If you cooperate...
What do you mean, cooperate?
The ancient book of Oriana.
What? A book? Is it the script? Too late for that, I'm afraid. The Duke threatens Oriana until she finally hands over some book that the Duke wants, and after a very eye-shattering light show, he reveals the book to say,
"Some kind of joke? Truth? Love? Wisdom?
Peace on earth was all it said."
After a bit of a hissy fit, the Duke unveils his greatest creation to unleash upon the cast, the Master Cylinder.
You're the grass and I'm the monitor.
But almost immediately, Felix throws the book at him, quite literally in fact, thus destroying the Ravebot's army, and finally the Duke, as the Master Cylinder falls upon him. Or dissolves on him, whatever works. Or is he?
I'll be back.
Actually, yes, that's it. It's over. So Felix bids farewell to this craptastical world and heads back home along with the professor and his nephew.
You have a heart of gold.
Righty-o!
Felix the Cat!
So that's the Felix the Cat hang on. Oh, crap. Not again. You see what this movie does to me?
There is so much that I could talk about, but to sum it all up, this is just one big mess. The animation is, well, mushy. Characters seem like they're just there for the sake of existing. We're left to wonder why Felix the Cat was in this in the first place. It's almost like they built a whole new concept and just added Felix in there to sell the idea. But no! Remember, this was actually going to be a TV show afterwards, so... did this really tell us anything about an actual show? No, and neither did it tell us about Felix, other than he was the main hero. It had a few characters and references from the 60s TV show, and that's about it. But by itself, it left me so confused about everything, because the entire story seemed so, well, unnecessary. I can say that a few years later, the Twisted Tales of Felix the Cat premiered, and despite its short run, actually held true to the original silent films while keeping it modern, as well as mixing in some classic Fleischer and Mesmer styles. It even had some references to the TV show, but didn't surround itself with it. If you can find any episodes, I do suggest giving it a watch. It's cheesy and weird, but it's fun, visual, pleasing cheese. But in all reality, nothing can beat the classics. I might even suggest watch the 60s cartoon. As dumb as it is, it actually can be pretty funny sometimes.
Now that it's over with, I need to figure out where the hell I am so I can go home and never see or talk about this weird-ass movie ever again.
Thank you.